let me just get this out of the way because I know it's controversial. I will not be weighing in on the Wolverine spikes. I'm not touching that. I'm not touching it. I know where your governor's at, but I cannot get involved. I'm not sadder on that. I mean, I was just down in Georgia. They're feeling pretty good about their Bulldogs right now. But I know the Wolverines and Coach Harbaugh might have something to say about that playoff time. And I know Governor Wetner is pulling for the upset tonight. But I am not here to talk about college football. I am here, you may be surprised to know, I am here to ask you to vote for your Congresswoman Rashida Tlaib, for your Attorney General Dana Nessel, for your Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson, for your Lieutenant Governor Garland Gilchrist, and for the great governor of the great state of Michigan.
And then you've got an erosion of
civility, acting right, including in our politics, our democratic norms. We've got politicians who work to stir up division, to try to make us angry and afraid of one another for their own advantage. And all of it gets amped up, hyped up, 24/7 by social media. Because a lot of times, they're for-profit platforms and they find it more profitable to feed you controversy and conflict instead of facts and truth. And sometimes it can turn dangerous. And I want to take a moment to say a prayer for a friend of mine, Mr. Paul Pelosi, who was attacked. 82 years old, was attacked when somebody broke into his home looking for his wife, Nancy. And thankfully, doctors believe he's going to be okay, but we'll let the investigators do their job. But here's one thing that we can feel, we know. If our rhetoric about each other gets that mean, when we don't just disagree with people, but we start demonizing them, making wild, crazy allegations about them, that creates a dangerous climate. And if elected officials don't do more to explicitly reject that kind of rhetoric, if they tacitly support it or encourage their supporters to stand up, side voting places armed with guns, dressed in tactical gear, more people can get hurt. And we're going to be violating the basic spirit of this country. Yes. So, sir, I'm dealing with, come on. But this is what I mean. This is what I mean. Sometimes it's tempting just to tune out. Watch football. Watch Dancing with the Stars. But I'm here to tell you that tuning out is not an option. Moping is not an option. You know, I didn't mope as a kid mostly, but sometimes all kids start getting whiny or moping. My mother would be like, you know what will make you feel better? Go clean your room. Do something useful.
Right.
And I said, that won't make me feel better. And she said, all right, but it'll make me feel better. We don't have time to vote. The only way to make this economy fair is if we fight for it.
That's right.
All of us. The only way to save our democracy if we together work for all of us. And that starts with electing people who know you and who see you and who care about you, who understand what you're going through day in, day out. You did that 2 years ago when you sent Joe Biden to the White House. He is fighting for you every day. He's got your back. He's doing everything he can to put more money in your pockets, to make your streets safer, to bring back even more good-paying jobs here to Michigan. You did it when you voted to send Gary Peters, Debbie Stabenow out of the Senate, and Brenda Lawrence, and Sheila Clean, and Haley Stevens, who worked, by the way, in our White House, to help save the auto industry. Wait, I was getting to a good part here and you're about to be distracted again. Remember what I said now, don't be like that dog and up. Squirrel. Squirrel. Don't be distracted. Because I was making an important point here. So inflation's a problem. What is the Republican answer? Look, I mean, if they had a great answer, that'd be one thing. But you know what their big economic policy is? They want to gut Social Security and Medicare and then give big tax cuts to the wealthy and some of the most successful corporations in the world. That's their agenda. And by the way, that's their answer for everything. Debbie knows, Gary knows. Back in 2008, 2010, inflation was low, unemployment was high. What was their answer? Tax cuts for the wealthy and cut back on Social Security and Medicare. It doesn't matter what the problem is. No matter what. Listen, if there was an asteroid heading towards Earth, and we got everybody in the room, said, what are we going to do? I think we should cut taxes for the wealthy. No, that's not going to help you. How's that going to help you? I mean, it's great, I guess, if you only have one answer to every economic problem. You know, it'd be like you're taking a math test and you just said 8 every time. And that was always... Those answers won't help you. That's why Democrats have actual plans to take on drug companies to get lower prices, to get the oil industry to clean up its act, to pass laws to make housing more affordable. Leaders like Gretchen Whitmer are working to make sure cars are being built and high-tech manufacturing is being done right here in Michigan instead of China. That's an actual plan. And that's the choice in this election. That's what this is all about. You hear the Republicans talk a lot about crime right now. Now, violent crime has gone up over the last 7 years, by the way. They act like it just happened. Just last year, as if like the previous president wasn't there.
He wasn't.
And by the way, it didn't just happen in so-called blue states. Turns out it's gone up in conservative rural states too, where Republicans are in charge, but they don't mention that in the ads. So here's the question: who will fight to keep you and your family safe? They have promised promised if they get control of Congress, they'll spend the next 2 years investigating their political opponents, including Joe Biden. Some of them said they'll impeach Joe Biden. When you ask them what for, they're not sure yet. You're laughing, but it's true. They're all like, well, I don't know. We're trying to figure it out. Now, here's the question. How is that going to help you and your family if that's all they're spending their time doing? How's that going to help Michigan compete? Or do you stand a better chance with President Biden and Democratic leaders who've worked together, sometimes with Republicans, to pass an infrastructure bill that will create new jobs? Who've made health care and prescription drugs more affordable? Who made the single largest investment ever to fight climate change? That's the choice in this election between politicians who seem willing to do anything to get power and leaders like Gretchen, who share our values. Leaders who are practical and just want to make your lives better and move this country forward. And let me be clear about this mission. Because sometimes I'm at these Democratic rallies and I feel a little sad about this, because this hasn't always been such a starkly partisan thing. You know, my favorite president was a guy named Abe Lincoln. Helped found the Republican Party. It used to be that there were GOP members, including here in Michigan, who were actually on board with civil rights and championed investment in our infrastructure and believed in the rule of law. It wasn't that long ago. And you might not agree with them on everything, but you could work with them. If they were your neighbors, your friends, you talk to them. And there was a practical sense of how we could get stuff done. But these days, just about every Republican politician seems obsessed with two things. Owning the libs. Oh man, we're going to own the libs. And getting Donald Trump's approval. That seems to be their agenda. They are not interested in actually solving problems. They are interested in making you angry and then finding somebody to blame. Because that way they're hoping you may not notice, you may be distracted from the fact that they don't really have any answers to your problems. Now, I can tell you what Gretchen Whitmer is obsessed with. With all the noise, all the nonsense going on out there, all the chatter and the tweets and the TikToks, she's focused on the fundamentals. Good jobs, lower costs, better schools, and fix the damn roads. Now Gretchen's opponent, her plan would slash billions of dollars from education budgets. Do not boo. Vote. Booing doesn't help. They can't hear you boo, but they can hear you vote. So her plan would slash billions from the education budget, change Michigan's constitution to allow taxpayer dollars to go to private schools. Now, as governor, Gretchen made the largest investment in K-12 education in Michigan. And she did it without raising taxes, by the way. She closed the funding gap between wealthy and historically underfunded school districts. Something the last four governors here in Michigan had tried and failed to do, Gretchen got it done. She put Michiganders to work repairing over 13,000 lane miles of roads. That's a lot of roads. That'll take you to Miami and back more than four times. She's working to make sure that the electric cars that will drive on these roads are made right here in Detroit, right here in Michigan. That's what you want from a public servant. You don't want a lot of wild, crazy talk. You just want somebody who's doing their job. That's what Governor Whitmer is focused on. I mean, imagine if you hire your plumber. You got an overflowing toilet. It's a problem. He comes in, and you're waiting for the toilet to be fixed. You start. Have you heard about the latest conspiracy of the lizard people? And he starts talking to you about all this stuff. We got to do something about that. You'd be like, no. I just want you to fix my toilet. You'd find another plumber. When you got a good plumber, you keep the plumber. When you got somebody that knows how to do their job, you keep them doing that job. I see. This is great. I love having it. I should just take the band around. I really do like that. And you know, best of all, Governor Whitmer's, she really is willing to work with anybody to get stuff done. So far, she signed more than 900 bipartisan bills. Because creating jobs and fixing roads should not be a Democratic or a Republican issue. It should be something we can all get behind. Her opponent has different ideas, though. She seems to be focused on the latest Fox News conspiracy instead of what folks in Michigan actually need. The other day, I did not realize this. I did not. I read about this. Somebody had to show it to me. The other day, a video came out of Governor Whitmer's opponent claiming that Democrats have been working for decades to topple the United States because they're still upset about losing the Civil War. And that COVID restrictions were part of some master plan to do this. Now, first of all, what? 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 I mean, I know some folks go down these rabbit holes on the internet, they're up too late. But that's like a subway tunnel. That's deep. That's the darkest rabbit hole I've ever seen. And by the way, it's not like this quote was from, sometimes folks get quoted way back when they were in college after a frat party bender, and they just said something. And you kind of want to forgive them because you're all like, all right, I've been there. I remember right after that game, we got a little stupid. She said this 2 years ago. 2 years ago. So I guess that's what she actually thinks. Imagine if instead of coming up with a story about how us having to watch Tiger King in our sweatpants was somehow some kind of government plot. Imagine if she spent some time coming up with some ideas to create more jobs here in Michigan, or to give folks more health care, or to improve our schools. That's what you want from the governor of your state. Somebody who's focused on doing the job and focused on you. And then there's this. I mean, this is just an aside. I'm going to read you two headlines, both from the Detroit News. One says, Whitmer signs order aimed at lowering insulin costs in Michigan. These are actual headlines. Second headline. This is the second headline. Michigan Governor hopeful Tudor Dixon eaten by zombies in gory horror film. I don't actually have anything else to say. It's up to you folks, whoever you think is the better choice. Come on. I will say the storyline in the zombie film is probably more believable than what Governor Whitmer's opponents think happened in the last election. Michigan deserves somebody who's going to work every day and fight for you. Somebody who's already doing it. Who's done it not just as your governor, but for her entire career. And by the way, you also deserve somebody who's going to stand up for a woman's right to make her own health care. Abortion is a controversial issue in this country. It always has been. And I genuinely believe there are good people of conscience who may differ from me on this issue. But we should all agree that women everywhere should be able to control what happens with their own bodies. It shouldn't be controversial to say that the most personal of healthcare choices should be made by a woman and her doctor and not politicians. And that's why when the Supreme Court struck down Roe versus Wade, it was a wake-up call for a lot of people, especially young women who might have taken Roe for granted. And it was a reminder that a politicized court can reinterpret what we thought was well-settled constitutional rights. We can go backwards. We don't always just go forwards. And if Republicans take back the House and the Senate, we could be one presidential election away from a nationwide ban on access to abortion. And that could be the beginning. Look, I taught constitutional law for over a decade. I will tell you this. If a court does not believe in a zone of privacy that allows us to make certain decisions without the government interfering, then other freedoms that we take for granted are at risk. Justice Thomas has already said as much. If there's no right to privacy, then same-sex marriage will certainly be at risk. Almost every Republican in the House of Representatives already voted against guaranteeing a right to use contraception. You think about that. If they take back power, there's no guarantee birth control won't be on the agenda. Here in Michigan, this isn't even theoretical. Abortion rights are literally on the ballot. Right now, there's a law in the books from 1931 that would ban abortion in Michigan with no exception for rape or incest and could throw nurses and doctors in jail for caring for women. This is a law, by the way, 1931, this law was passed when women could be fired from their jobs simply for being a woman. At a time when women were actively discouraged from getting an education and going to college. But Governor Whitmer's opponent strongly supports it. A law from 1931. She thinks politicians had the right idea back then. I mean, she probably thinks if she watched The Handmaid's Tale, she's thinking like, what's the problem? But you know what? The good news is Governor Whitmer has other ideas. She's filed a lawsuit to block the 1931 law, to keep modern law preserving these rights here in Michigan. If you vote yes on Proposition 3, you can stop this radical shift for good and restore the rights that women have had for nearly 50 years here in Michigan. So, all these issues are at stake in this election. And not just for people here in the auditorium, but for people who are watching. If that's not worth 15 minutes of your time, I don't know what is. But you know what? If you do need another reason to go vote, I'll give you one more. And that is the fact that American democracy is also on the ballot. Now, I have to admit that sometimes going out on the campaign trail feels a little harder than it's used to. Not just because I'm older and grayer. I don't know if y'all heard that. Well, I'm sorry, what'd you say? Said I was so fine. I'm not gonna tell Michelle you said that. Although Michelle does agree. She knows. But that, we're getting distracted. Squirrel. yeah, I touched on this before, but I want to repeat this. Back when I was first running for the presidency, but even before that, when I was running for the U.S. Senate, people did not agree with me on everything. But I could go in a community, mostly Republican, mostly conservative, and I could have a conversation. I could sit in a VFW hall, I could sit at a diner, have a piece of pie, have a cup of coffee, talk to folks about their lives, tell them a little bit about myself. They might not end up voting for me, but they'd say, oh, you know, he seems like a decent guy, you know. And we might persuade each other on some things. And I learned something because of that conversation. And that's, by the way, how I ended up getting a whole bunch of Republican votes. That seems crazy, but I did. Way back. And that was only 2008. It wasn't that long ago. And then after I won, the Republican candidate, my colleague in the Senate, John McCain, graciously conceded. He wished me luck for the sake of the country. And it feels like that basic foundation of our democracy is now at risk. And you know, sometimes the way this gets reported is it's as if it's just the same on both sides. Look, Democrats are, we may not be perfect. I'm the first one to admit. No. Hold on a second. I want to make this point. Politicians, just like all of us, can make mistakes. Nobody's perfect. But I will. I know somebody like a Debbie Stabenow and a Gary Peet. I've worked with them. I served with them in the Senate. They will still treat people who disagree with them with civility, and they will still listen to people, and they will still try to come up with common sense solutions to problems, and they prefer working with people and not being divided. I know your governor feels the same way. And that's how our democracy is supposed to work. And so part of the reason it's harder now is because, with few notable exceptions, most Republican politicians right now are not even pretending that the rules apply to them anymore. They seem okay with just making stuff up. Governor Whitman's opponent has falsely claimed that the 2020 election was stolen. Now, and has refused to say whether she thinks Joe Biden has won. She just can't bring herself to do it. And I just want to explain this. Nobody likes losing. Listen, the first time I ran for Congress, I lost the primary by 30 points. I got whooped. And let me tell you, I was frustrated. I was frustrated too. You know what I didn't do though? I didn't claim the election was rigged. I didn't try to stop votes from being counted. I didn't incite a mob to storm the Capitol. I took my lumps. I figured out why my campaign hadn't connected. And I tried to run a better race the next time, because that's how our democracy is supposed to work.
To cast a ballot. She did the right thing.
Because she believes in the simple idea that every citizen deserves to have their vote counted. That didn't used to be controversial. These days, at least in GOP circles, it is. It shouldn't take courage to stand up for that idea, but we're running against folks who don't believe in it. That's why you've got to support Jocelyn. You've got to have her back, because there are Republicans who don't want to play by the rules. So we've got to keep Jocelyn in that job. Because if they get close, I can make a difference. Rex's got to go someplace else to she got to campaign other places. She already got you. Which brings me to my final. You've got to make a difference, too. You know, we joke in my house that Michelle can be a little glass half empty sometimes. I mean, she reads the news and sometimes it can get her a little low down. I'm the hope and change guy. So I'm usually a little more optimistic. So sometimes when she gets down about the state of the country or the state of the world, I tell her everything's going to be okay. And I believe it will be. But I also know that things won't be okay on their own. We have to fight for it. We've got to work for it. Not just on election day, but every day in between. That's why this election matters to us. I know these are tough times, but we've been through tough times before. The thing is, we can't give in to the temptation to give up. We can't turn inward. We can't see politics as a zero-sum game where anything goes. And the rules are broken, and the only way people like us win is people like them lose. We can't give in to that kind of thing. Because in our darkest moments, and there have been darker moments before, we have always had more in common than our politics suggests. Even when times are tough, what unites us can be stronger than what divides us. There have been certain values that bind us together as citizens, no matter who we are, where we come from, what we look like, who we love. That's the promise of America. That's who we are. And in this election, you've got a chance to vote for leaders like Gretchen Whitmer, and Donovan Gilchrist, and Jocelyn Benson, and David Messel, and Rashida Tlaib, who will fight for that big, inclusive, hopeful, forward-looking America that we all believe in, an America that doesn't fear the future, that meets its challenges honestly and boldly, an America where we may not fix all our problems overnight, but where we can make things better. And better is worth fighting for. So if you're scared, if you're anxious, if you're frustrated, don't complain, don't boo, don't tune out, don't get distracted, don't get bamboozled, don't fall for the okey-doke that says nothing you say or do matters. You go out and what? Get off your couch and what? Put down your phone and what? Vote for this incredible Michigan Democratic Senate. Help your friends and your family and your neighbors and your co-workers do the same. And if enough of us make our voices heard, things will be better. We will heal what ails us. We'll restore our democracy. We're going to build a country that's more fair and more just and more equal and more free. That is our task. That's our responsibility. Let's get to work. Thank you, Detroit. Thank you, Michigan.